was younger, you know, in the 80s, it was easier to get kids in the gym. In the 80s, we had Rocky, right? Rocky got kids in the gym. There's no Rocky today. So what we do is we try and, you know, appeal to their sense of adventure.
We've been running this after-school program now in various iterations for about 30 years. So what we do is we offer 3 days a week free boxing training for kids. That involves them coming in, being able to work under a coach, getting healthy snacks, getting mentorship. Basically, it's a program that not only focuses on physical fitness, but also on mental health and building up their self-esteem, building up their resilience.
I was an angry kid before because I didn't really know how to express myself. This was like one of the ways that I could express myself and I wouldn't get really judged because I was just hitting the bag.
I let them be who they want to be. I don't insist that they don't swear. I don't insist that they don't listen to music they want. Those are those trivial things that I don't really care about. My main focus is that they interact with each other properly in a healthy fashion, that they show respect to the coaches and to each other, and that they have work ethic.
I thought I was going to be here for like a week, maybe a couple classes, and then just drop out. But there's something about Eastside with their crew and their coaches. It's feel like you're at home.
I love the fact that we provide a safe haven for kids to come and learn about physical health, mental health, discipline, building self-esteem, and you know what they can do in life when they set goals and work towards achieving them.
I had a spot like this when I was growing up. I could go there and work out. I could go there and get a good meal when home wasn't an option. And every time I left that place, I felt good about myself. I felt better about myself.
I like to see kids do better. I like to see the fact that their grades get better. I like to see that they get a little more responsibility. I like to see that they actually, start caring a little bit more about what they're doing. They actually develop more of a bit of self-respect.
It takes funding from the public in order to do that, in order to keep our doors open, in order to make sure that safe space and the training exists for the people who come here and speak to how it's changed their lives.
You know, Aprons for Gloves keeps the gym going, keeps the kids' programs going. What's really important to me is that, you know, between the ages of like 25 to 35 in the hospitality industry are coming together to raise money for these kids. That's huge. The amount of money we've raised is amazing.
We rely largely on donations and sponsorship. Please donate, and this is where your money goes.
You can come by that gym at 3:30 to 5, and you can see where your money's going. It's not smoke and mirrors, this is the real deal.
If any of this sounds like it appeals to you, you want to get in shape, you want to work on not just physical fitness, but mental fitness, you want to build resiliency, come join us. The doors are always open.
I got what you want. Good afternoon, everybody. How's everybody doing? Not bad, not bad. Welcome to the 10th anniversary of Restaurant Rumble, presented by Aprons for Gloves Boxing Association. My name is Don Andrews. I'm going to be your host for this morning, this afternoon, and this evening, and probably late into the night. Before we get started, we'd first like to take the time to acknowledge we are on the traditional territories of the Coast Salish people, in particular, the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh First Nations. So for the past 10 years, Aprons for Gloves partnered with Eastside Boxing Club to bring you an action-packed day of amateur boxing, all in the name of serving the community of the downtown Eastside. The success wouldn't have been possible without the collaborative efforts of our members and our community. Thanks to your support, we're able to offer boxing training, mentorship, food, and connection to community resources, rather, helping to give our youth the skills and opportunities they need to succeed. None of this is possible without our sponsors, our contenders, our donors, and supporters like each and every one of you. So thank you. For more information on Eastside's programs, or if you'd like to make a donation, please visit the merch table. So, as you know, our contenders have been training hard over the past 14 weeks in preparation for their respective bouts today and this evening. We'd like to remind you that with any sport, boxing carries with it risk of injury. If anybody should appear to be injured, please don't be alarmed. Our very qualified medical staff is on hand to make sure that we take care of all and any situations. Don't worry about it. We got it. Without further ado, let's get this show started. Before we do, it's my pleasure. Would you please rise, remove your hats, and join us as we honor tonight's fighters with the singing of our national anthem, Here to Sing, O Canada. Please welcome Lindsay Highgate.
Land, true patriot love in all of us command. With glowing hearts we see thee rise, the true north strong and free. From far and wide, O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. God keep our land glorious and free. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee.
Come on, make some noise for Lindsay Highgate. All right, fans, please have a seat. Anybody here want to watch somebody punch another person in the face? That's what we were hoping for. Please welcome our first fighters to the ring. First one out from the blue corner. Make some noise for Adrian Pinder. For Gloves Boxing Association is proud to present our first fight of the night. This fight exhibition bout is scheduled 3 rounds of boxing. Your referee in charge of the action at the bell is referee Clark McClellan. Now fans, our judges are ready. The fighters are ready. For the hundreds in attendance and the millions watching around the globe, Fans, it's time now to start this year's Restaurant Rumble! Introducing first, Mallet fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the black trunks with white trim, his official weight, 158 pounds even. Please welcome Adrian Elbows Pinder! His opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the red trunks with white trim, his official weight, 159 pounds. Please welcome Sam Wham Bam Slammin' Sam Kapulia!
Welcome to the 10th annual Aprons for Gloves. I'm Dave Shook, and I'm with Luke Creighton here presenting the action. We're on to our first bout. The blue corner is Adrian Pinder, and he will be fighting Sam Kapulia. It's be an interesting bout. I think that what we're going to see here is these guys are going to be going right at each other, Luke.
I definitely agree. They both look like they're in shape.
And here we go. See Pinder using that jab effectively. Kapulia is coming forward, but you notice he's kind of looking towards the ground, which is generally not a good idea in this sport. The general rule of thumb is you look to the ground, you're going to end up on the ground. So,
yeah, Pinder is definitely looking straight forward and pumping that jab out.
Yeah, lots of jabs. Busy, nice right hand. Oh, a big swing by Kapulia. Doesn't quite connect, but he's got to keep his eye on the target or he's not going to be hitting much but air. What I'd like to see from Sam is that he loosens up a bit. Well, this being his first foray into the sport of boxing, you're seeing a little bit of the nerves and he seems almost a little agitated at this moment. So there we go. Nice right hand by him. Bell rings. Here we go. First round of action down. How would you have that round?
I would say I would give that to Adrian easy. An easy round for Adrian. I think Sam definitely needs to establish his jab in the next round and just relax a little bit.
Yep, I agree. Well, let's see what Abdul Fidel can do to calm him down and get him to kind of commit a little more and like I said, get him to stop looking at the ground.
Yeah, no more looking at the ground, establishing the jab and just focusing on moving forward and keeping his eyes on his opponent.
Let's have a look at some highlights here. And you're seeing that jab. Even that one was a little bit of a push, but it did do its job, and that was to offset the rhythm of Kapulia.
Yeah, I think Adrian is doing exactly what he should be doing for his first fight.
Kapulia got a nice right hand in there, so it's not like he's totally, getting outworked, but he's not doing enough to win the round, in my opinion, so let's see what he can do to make some adjustments.
Well, Sam's coming out with fire this round.
Oh yeah, he's trying for that big right hand.
Abdul must have stirred something up deep within him.
Yeah, well, I think he just told him, look at your opponent and throw straighter punches, which is pretty much,
sometimes
at this level, that's the advice you want to get, nothing too fancy.
Sometimes it can be that simple, Dave.
Oh, nice left to right. Kapulia landing. Adrian's got to start stepping around just like he's doing there to catch an angle, get his opponent off balance.
It feels like Adrian's coming back to the Adrian in the first round.
Yes.
Straight punches.
Kapulia thought that, I think he thought that was the bell. But that was not. What happens is they knock. They had a little knocker and they give you a 10-second warning. He's all right.
He's good.
But that was a justified 8 count. The bell. And now we're going into the final round. Remember, these are 1 minute rounds in these undercard fights.
Just gonna ask, Dave. They seem pretty
short. Oh, they are short. So you got to get off early and you got to push the action, or next thing you know it, the fight's over and you haven't done enough.
How would you score it so far, Dave?
I gotta go with 2-0 for Pinder. Kapulia snapped out of it and he landed some nice shots, but At this point, for him to win it, I think he's got to do something very drastic. He would need to knock him out.
I would agree with that. I think if he would have kept the energy in the first half of the second round, he could have maybe taken it.
Look at these replays here. And what you're seeing there is a little bit more of a varied attack from Pinder. He went the body a little bit. And nice punches from Caviglia. Okay, here's our final round. Pinder coming out, doing a lot of movement. Nice. Now they're starting to let it all hang out.
They are both going for it.
Yep, Caviglia's trying.
Oh, big right by Pinder.
Another A count.
That was a big right
hand. I don't think he was necessarily hurt from that shot, but you know what? I like to see them here on the side of caution. It is, you know, this is a charity event, so we don't want anyone getting banged up too bad. And here we go. Let's have a look. Oh, a nice jab. And it looks like Pender's coming in to finish it, but you better be careful. Oh, nice right hand by Pinder. Caviglia returns. A little bit of wrestling. And we are done.
What a fight, Dave.
That was a hell of a matchup, but you know, at the end of the day, you got to look at the guy who did a little bit more, and that's Adrian Pinder. Caviglia made a nice accounting of himself. Was it enough to win the fight? I don't think so.
Yeah, I think we definitely have to give this one to Pinder. Showed a lot of heart in there.
Hats off to both guys. This ain't easy. It's easy for people to sit at home and watch this and say, I would have done that, I could have done that. Bullshit. There's a reason these guys did all the work and they're in there and you're not.
Couldn't agree more, Dave.
But both guys look like they left it all out, and there you see both guys breathing pretty heavy. But I really don't see any other way to go with this other than, a clear-cut win for Pinder. As you look in this replay here.
I would have given every round to Pinder on that belt.
Well, let's have a look here.
What do you think, Mike Pinder? Is that a good way to start tonight? Oh, come on, that's better. The best part about an exhibition bout is that everybody's a winner. Congratulations, you guys did great.
So, this was technically a sparring match.
Just want to acknowledge really quickly as well while you're still clapping. These guys have been training 14 weeks. In the blue corner, they've been training with Brian Grant. And in the red corner, they've been training with Abdul Fadel. These guys have been working hard. Get all these fighters ready. So know that we appreciate both you trainers. Thank you.
So both guys get their hands raised, but... looking at it from my point of view, if I had to make a decision, you know where it went. It went to Adrian Pinder, but good job on both gentlemen. And we're on to our next bout. I'd like to thank everybody for coming and joining us. We've got people as far as Australia. My good friend Arthur wins in Australia. Hi, Arthur. Hi, Kylie, his beautiful wife. Nice to see that you guys are tuned in. Everybody else, thank you very much for joining us. It's been a hell of a 2 years.
What a turnout tonight, eh, Dave?
Yeah, this is a good turnout. It's a different venue than what we traditionally use. We're usually at the Commodore, but the Commodore is very, very, very busy right now due to all the concerts being pushed back because of COVID. And we're back. And it was a long, hard struggle going through COVID, but thanks to the support of everybody, we've carried on doing what we're doing.
And Dave, this is what it's all about. Two opponents hugging it out at the end of a fight.
That's right. Well, there's no bad blood between people here. We all operate as a team. We train together. Everybody knows each other. That doesn't diminish the fact that they're still trying to knock each other's heads off.
So what do you know about our next opponents, Dave?
Well, next we've got a woman's fight. This is Bernice Lowe versus Christina Kennett. This will be an interesting fight. Kennett's got a bit of a reach advantage over Lowe, but Lowe's got what you call dogged determination. So it's going to be an interesting matchup. I'm not going to predict the winner, but I'll tell you, there will be some fireworks.
I think that's what we're all here for.
All right, fight fans, let's keep that noise going. Second fight of the night. First, making their way to the ring from the blue corner, Bernice Lowe.
And here comes Bernice Lowe. Bernice, is that actually originally from France, living in Vancouver?
Now making their way to the ring from the red corner, Christina Kennett.
There's a bit of a height advantage going to Kennett.
Fight fans, our second fight of the night. Three rounds in our AFGBA Women's Lightweight Division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the white trunks with black trim, her official weight, 131 pounds. Please welcome Bernice the Raven Lowe. Her opponent fighting out of the red corner, wearing the black trunks with white trim, her official weight, 128 pounds. Please welcome Christina Kennett. Your referee in charge of the action of the bell is Brendan Lowry.
And there we go. These girls are not that short. It's that Brendan Lowry, the referee, is 6'10". Large gentleman, used to box himself, had a very, very successful amateur career. So here we go.
What would be your keys to victory for each fighter, Dave?
Well, Kenneth's got to use the jab. Got to step around, use the jab, use the movement. Bernice has got to do exactly what she's doing, and that's just coming forward to you know, upset the rhythm and take that reach advantage away from Kenneth. But Kenneth's a tough little character, I'll tell you.
Oh yeah, she's got a good jab on her too, and a nice right hand there.
Oh yeah, she throws nice long straight punches, and she's very focused. What I'm liking, what I'm seeing with Bernice, is that she's going to the body a bit. She's not just head hunting. There she goes. She's got to finish up with something up top after that right hand to the body, though.
Exactly.
And Kennett going to the body, which is impressive. But this, you know, these girls are both first fights. So for them to go to the body, so it's a testament to their training.
And Kennett's sticking out that nice long jab. It's effective so far.
But she just got caught with some nice body shots there. Nice right hand by Lowe. So that round, that's a tough one to score. What you notice there, it seemed to me that Kennett was getting a little bit more, you know, warmed up as opposed to Bernice coming straight in. And watch these highlights here. You're gonna have a look here. Nice jab, Kennett. But hopefully we could see some of those body shots.
Yeah, they actually both went to the body that round.
They did, and that's impressive.
Especially for Kennett. I was surprised to see her go down there.
Yep, no, it's great. Now, what I think's going to happen here, I think that Kennett's going to really try and pull forward with that jab and movement. I think she's going to really try and snap that jab out. So, let's see if she's going to do what I'm saying she should do. Get the jab out and kind of keep this girl off her front foot and move around.
Exactly, and I think we need to see Lowe just go straight forward and just attack the body.
Exactly. There we go.
Right away.
But it's a little danger in going to the body at times, because your hand. Oh, nice right hand, Kennett coming
Two
forward.
Right hands by Kennett.
Yeah, beautiful, nice jab. So we're looking, you know, Kennett seems to be accelerating. She's a very, very focused and driven woman. But let's not take anything away from the efforts of Bernice Lowe. Lowe's got to get busier with her jab. She's got to throw two to, ooh, a nice straight right hand.
That was a very nice right hand.
And you see, it's all the movement. What you're seeing is with Kennett's got the understanding that if I move, she and Lowe sets her right foot, I could hit her with those right hands.
Yeah, Lowe is just throwing one or two punches and not actually getting on the inside.
Yeah. That's well, that was a more dominant round for Kennett once again. I would have to say it's 2-0 for Kennett.
I would agree with that. I would say we've seen some moments from Lowe, but I think she needs to not stop at one or two punches, throw more, get on the inside. And punish Kennett.
Yeah, well, these one-minute rounds go fast, so she might as well just go out there, empty the gas tank, and see what kind of damage she can do this round. She's not going to win it doing what she's doing. I'm sure Brian Grant is telling her that you've got to go forward and you got to take a few chances now.
I was just going to say that's one of the best coaches in the game right there. I'm sure he's getting her all fired up for the last round.
Yeah, no, I think it's do or die at this moment for her. Oh, the mouthpiece was forgotten. That happens sometimes. Oh, look at Bernice Lowe coming. Look at Kennett's not gonna stand up for that.
Lowe is hunting now. Lowe is not holding back.
Lowe's gotta keep going. She's gotta start the exchanges and finish them. But look at walking through fire to get her job done. You gotta admire that.
Kennett just has good, strong basics. That's hard to beat.
Like I said, these rounds go fast. Oh, Bernice is getting hammered now.
Kennett laying it on.
Good job, girls.
What a fight, dude.
That was a good fight. But I just seem to, the bottom line is Kennett landed the cleaner shots and she threw a lot more shots. So both girls did a great job, but if you look at the replay, nice right hand there. Caught her coming in.
It even seemed like on the inside, Kennett had the advantage.
Well, yeah, she fired nice straight punches. But I'm thinking that maybe this fight would be the type of fight that you might want to see again after they both train for another year.
I would definitely watch that. Kennett actually looks like she could go a couple more rounds, Dave.
She's a very, very tough person. Look at the height of Brendan. He's a giant.
6'10", you say?
Yeah, 6'10". Great guy. Really nice guy.
You know how many amateur fights he had?
I had about 50.
That's not a bad amateur career right there.
No. He is now a detective with the VPD.
Fight fans, after three rounds of action, we go to the judges' scorecard for a decision. All three judges score this the same for your winner by unanimous decision. In the red corner, Christina Kennett.
Well-deserved victory. But let's not take anything away from Bernice Lowe. And we're getting ready for our next matchup, which will be an excellent one. We got Vince Lowe versus Colin Palos. It's going to be a very, very interesting fight. Let's take it back to Don Andrews. The referee is Derek Hoy.
Fight fans, let's keep that noise going as we welcome the next two fighters to the ring. First, from the blue corner, Vince Lowe.
Well, let's see how Vince Lowe looks coming in here. It's nerve-wracking being, fighting in front of hundreds of people, but he seems pretty calm to me.
His opponent from the red ring, connection from the red corner, Colin Palos.
Colin Palos, probably one of the better pure boxers in aprons for gloves this year. You can see there's a little swagger there when he walks in.
Oh, there you go. He looks focused.
He is focused. This will be a good fight.
Fight fans, our third fight of the night. Three rounds for our AFGBA men's welterweight division. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the black and white trunks, his official weight, 145 pounds. Please welcome Vince the Prince Lowe. His opponent, the man fighting out of the red corner, wearing the white trunks with black lettering, his official weight, 150 pounds. Please welcome Colin Royal Palos. Your referee in charge of the bell is Mr. Derek Hoy.
Looking a little heavier set there, eh?
One guy's got a decided reach advantage, but Palos is taller, but I'll tell you, Vince Lowe's a strong, strong man. Look for Palos to use the reach. Look for Vince to come out and start trying to bang right away. 1 minute round, so they gotta get to work.
Especially in this small ring, eh, Dave?
Oh, yeah. Let's go! Oh, Lowe coming out like I thought.
Lowe getting right to work.
Looping right hand. Better be careful, because Palos will catch him coming in with that. You gotta keep that chin down.
His hands up after he finishes combination.
That's right. Well, they've got the right idea. Come out fast, because it's a 1 minute round, but don't do it recklessly.
Yeah, Vince needs to leave a little bit of space between him and his opponent when he's punching.
That's right. What's concerning me about Vince is the chin being up in the air.
Yeah, whenever he fires, his chin is right there for the taking. Like, what a left hand there.
Yeah.
Almost caught him.
Oh, little headgear malfunction.
No mercy from Colin.
Well, defend yourself at all times.
Amen, Dave.
I'd like to see Colin relax a little bit, look to time those shots. Okay, we got the bell.
Round is over.
Yeah, they go fast. These guys are looking like that's it. Okay, let's talk turkey here. Bottom line, Vince has got to keep the chin down. He's got to straighten his punches out. Those wide ones, that was a nice shot there, but a lot of times you're taking a lot of energy throwing those.
And I would say he's getting just a little too close to his opponent.
That's right.
Smothering himself a little bit.
That's right, but the big shot for that round was that shot.
But I would say at the end of the day, he actually did. It was better for him to keep the pressure on.
Yep. No, he has to keep the pressure on, but he's got to be a little bit more respectful of Colin's power. Because if you got your chin up and you're rushing in there, a nice, well-placed straight shot can discombobulate you very easily.
I would agree with that. I'd say Paulus almost caught him with a couple, but not quite. Let's see how this round ends.
Colin's got to straighten him out. He's got to get back to boxing and play his game. Nice jab. Ooh. Wrestling. Let's keep it clean, gentlemen.
Oh, he's right back to it. He is not giving him any breathing room.
No.
He's got to keep his hands up.
Nice body work. Oh, Collins all fired up. Low. Oh, nice spin.
Lowe has to keep his hands up or this could get dangerous.
Lowe's really energized. He's got to just calm down to be effective. Like I like where his brain's at with the activity, but you gotta respect the fact that after you throw those big shots, your hands are down, you're gonna get caught. And now you're seeing Collins trying to take advantage of that.
I'd say Collins' boxing skills are coming to light this round.
Ooh, nice left hook, nice right hand.
Me too.
Well, Luke, what would you score this fight so far? Who won the first round?
I would say it's 1-1 right now. I'd say one round for Lowe at the beginning, and I'd say Paulus edged out the last round.
I tend to agree with you on that one.
It would actually surprise me in this last round if I feel like Paulus is getting some momentum here.
Yep.
And his boxing kind of started to shine halfway through the last round.
Yeah, so look at his highlight. See, that's what I'm talking about. You're missing those big shots and the chin's coming.
He's too close there. He's not effective in that.
Yeah. And Collins can't play his game. Collins got to straighten his shots out and not get caught up in the brouhaha of that.
I'd actually like to see him just move a little bit more, throw some stiff jabs.
That's right.
Set something up.
Yeah. Well, here we go.
Paulo's getting the crowd fired up.
Both of them are. Let's do it.
Oh, big right hand.
Big kibosh.
A bit of a wrestling match in there.
Well, what happens? These guys get so keyed up that, you know, they just, oh, nice right hand.
Yeah, right hand. Another right hand by Lowe.
That's it. Straighter punches by Paulus. This is anyone's
huge
fight.
Right
nice
hand.
Right hand. That stunned him. But he's doing the right thing. He's tying him up. Paulus has got to go forward. Vince just showed him, hey, I'm tired. I'm a little hurt. Oh, nice straight right hand.
What a fight, Dave.
Oh, this is a good
one. Barn burner here.
This is a good one. Oh, protect yourself. Go.
Paulo says no.
Oh, that had a lot of stink on it, that one.
I think Lowe's getting a little tired here.
Yeah. Oh, that right hand hurt.
But
he's leaving himself open. Got a fight.
Woo-hoo. Like I said, Dave, sometimes the first fight is better than watching experienced fighters.
Well, what you're seeing here is you're seeing 3 minutes of pure action. You know, a two-minute bout's a different animal altogether. These ones are pretty savage. So let's have a look at these highlights coming up. Let's see who won that last round. Who are you thinking won that?
I'm not going to lie. That was a close fight.
That's a close round.
I mean, I wouldn't even be surprised if it was a draw.
Yeah, that round was pretty tight.
What would you say, Dave?
Oh, man, I don't know. I'm not even going to venture to guess what they're going to score. I think Paulus took this fight by the slimmest of margins. I think he was just a little bit more, better rounded.
A little more boxing IQ.
Yeah, he had a little more technique. Not to take anything away from Lowe, because, man, he brought it.
Lowe was an absolute savage in there.
Well, both guys seem to
that
really
was the definition
bring it tonight.
Of take one to give one.
Yeah, and here, look at this. Bang, nice jab. And those are the punches, I think, that are going to win the fight because they're more traditional boxing punches than just the big wild right hands. Well, let's see. All
it's going to be close. Let's see what they have to say. Tabulating the scorecards.
Are we entertained or what? This is only the third fight of the night. We're going to rip the roof off this place. After three rounds, we went to the judges' scorecard for decision. They all see this the same for your winner by unanimous decision. In the red corner, Colin Royal Palace.
That was what I predicted. But man, what a performance by both gentlemen. Vince Lowe definitely brought it tonight. I think the judges just seem to like the more traditional boxing stuff. But what a heck of a fight we had. Sportsmanship by both. And back to Don Andrews here for the next bout.
Fighters are ready to go again. Fourth fight of the night. First one to the ring in the blue corner, Amr Alamadi. Now making their way to the ring to the red corner, James Manzano.
James Manzano, obviously the favorite with the crowd.
Fight fans, fourth fight of the night. We have three rounds again in our AFGBA men's middleweight division. Introducing first to my left, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the blue trunks with white trim, his official weight, 159 pounds. Please welcome Amr, the Polar Bear Alamadina. His opponent across the ring, man, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the white trunks with black lettering, his official weight, 161 pounds. Please welcome James Manzano! At the bell, your referee in charge of the action is Jason Flynn.
Well, this will be an interesting fight. Manzano.
He's looking extra relaxed.
He's a southpaw. He's a shifty kind of guy. Medina's a little stiffer. So let's see how this translates.
Definitely got a high lead hand. I'd say right off the bat, Manzano is looking very relaxed.
Yep.
Does he have any amateur experience before this?
No. This is his first fight, but.
He's looking very relaxed for his first fight.
Yeah, I know, he's just got that type of personality. He's a very, very chill guy. Medina's got to start just throwing that right hand. Conviction.
He needs to keep his chin down, though.
Yeah, that's right.
He needs to keep his chin down.
They got Wawa there, a straight left hand.
What I was talking talking about he was leaving his chin.
Well, he was looked a little stiff to me at the beginning, and heck, this is their first bout. Who wouldn't be stiff? Nice. Saved by the bell. I'm Brian Grant. I'm telling him, dude, relax. I'd work on his breathing. For the first half of the minute round, just get his breathing. Tell him just keep your chin down, keep your punches straight. Nothing too fancy for advice with that. Now, if I'm Abdul Fidel and I'm talking to Manzano, I'm telling Manzano, go in behind your jab. Don't get too carried away with coming in with like lead uppercuts and stuff like that. Just take a simple route by following everything behind the, everything's falling behind the jab, keeping the punches a little tighter, and get your guy out of there.
Wild, I would say. But he looks very natural in there.
He is. He can get this kid out of here. He's already showed us that he can do some damage to Almadine.
I would actually be surprised if he didn't in this round.
Well, I think that's on his. I think that's what he's going to come out and try and do. Almadine's keeping the hands up. Nice. The chin down would be nice.
There you go.
And,
I think what you're going to see here is he's stiff. It's really hard to absorb a shot when you're stiff, but look for the straight left hand there.
Manzano might just be a little too much for him.
I think he is. We're going for the second eight count.
Yeah, he doesn't look too hurt to me.
No, he's not hurt, but what happens when you're stiff is you feel the punches a lot more than if you were relaxed because your body's all jammed up, it's all tight.
Right back.
Oh,
at
and he comes back though. Give the kid some credit. He's got to throw the straight right hand though. Okay, so.
He could just relax a little bit. I feel like he'd be a lot more effective.
Well, these are these people's first fight, so you know, you're going to have to expect a few people to be keyed up. And that's all right. This is a learning experience. My hope is that no one really gets banged up too hard tonight. And they learn from the experience, and they enjoy it. It's kind of hard to enjoy it if you're getting hit with a really, you know, with a volume of shots. Let's look at this replay over here. You're seeing that left hand.
And a big right hook by Red there.
Yeah.
And another.
Yeah. That one kind of stunned him. But the ref did the good thing to call an eight count because the kid wasn't answering back.
What do you think the third round holds for us,
Dave? I think the third round is Manzano coming out trying to get this guy out of the ring. And I hope that Almadina does the right thing and moves, keeps his chin down, and throws the right hand. He can hit this guy the right hand coming in.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, it looks like we have a shoulder injury.
I wonder what happened to his arm,
know.
Dave.
Well, hopefully we can have a replay and we can see what happened there. I'm thinking elbow or shoulder.
As an amateur boxer who blew his bicep out in the ring, I can I can relate to this.
Oh, it would suck.
It looks like a shoulder injury.
Yeah, and you know, that's common. Oh, no. The fight is over. And that will actually go down as a stoppage win for Almadine.
I don't think any of us were expecting this for the third.
No, game. But you know, what happens a lot of times, he's probably had a little bit of history with that shoulder.
But also, he was throwing his punches quite wide, and that actually puts a lot of force on your shoulders if you don't turn them over.
Yeah, it does. But I think that probably, if we ask him, there's probably a little history of some shoulder problems. And the thing, when you're all keyed up and you're ready to go, the adrenaline courses through your veins, and you throw shots, and your body's giving it everything, and I think it just knocked that shoulder right out of the socket, and I don't know if it's in yet. It still looks like it's out to me. They're going to have to apply a little traction and get that out. What a shame.
What a shame. That was the makings of a real good fight, Dave.
He was on his way to taking that fight home, too. So what the doctor's going to do is he's going to apply a little traction and get that shoulder popped back in. We're going to probably, we've got a medic on it, following a doctor in there.
So does this bout go to Al-Madin now?
I would believe so. My understanding of the rules, yes. You never know what's going to happen. What a shame, though.
That was a good fight there.
Fight fans, your referee Jason Flynn has to stop this fight 48 seconds of the third round for your winner by ref stoppage due to injury. From the blue corner, Amr, the polar bear, Al-Madin.
Yeah, you can see on his face he didn't want to win like that. But you know what? What can you do? But man, I'll tell you, a bit popping your shoulder out hurts. Oh God, it is a sickening feeling. Now the bouts won't continue until the doctor's back at ringside. So let's hope they get the poor kid's shoulder popped back in, get him iced up. There's really not much you can do about that injury other than pop it back in and ice it.
Was it a dislocated shoulder?
Yes, it looked like a dislocated. I think I could see it hanging a little bit.
Who do we have up next, Dave?
We have a hell of a girls' match. We've got Valerie Sauter versus Larina Amarez Garcia. And I'll tell you, that's going to be a battle. That's going to be a battle. Both are very, very, very intense.
I'll be more supportive. I made mistakes. I bumped my head. And court sucked me dry.
I would have to give the edge.
Baby, please. Can't let her grow up in that ghetto universe.
I would give it to Sauter, but here's the thing, man. Some people look great in the gym, and then when it comes time for the lights to shine on them, they get a little antsy, and they don't perform as well. What you do in the actual gym, ring and not the gym. I've known a lot of people that were great in the gym, and then they kind of froze up. So we're going to see what we got to
Garcia harnesses the Mexican fighting style.
Oh, Garcia's a tough nut.
All right, fight fans, minor delay, but we're ready for our fifth fight of the night. Welcome them as they make their way to the ring. From the blue corner, Valerie Sauter.
Valerie comes running in. Lots of energy.
He's intense.
We could be together.
Now making their way to the ring from the red corner, Lorena Almarez Garcia.
And here we go.
Garcia's got the full robe on and
ready
to go.
She ain't playing. Neither of these girls is gonna play. They're gonna bring it.
When they walk in with a smile, Dave, that's when you know.
It could be a nervous smile, though.
Strike fans, our fifth fight of the night. Three rounds in our AFGBA Women's Lightweight Division.
Introducing you looking
first
at the reach?
To my left, fighting out of the blue corner.
Little reach advantage.
Wearing the blue trunks with white trim. Her official weight, 127 pounds. Please welcome Valerie Bad Girl Sauter. Her opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the black trunks with white lettering. Her official weight, 128 pounds. Please welcome Lorena Gunner Alvarez Garcia.
Well, well, well.
Garcia's at the bell, your referee turns the action is Brennan Lowry.
Let's see who comes out smoking on this one.
But you see there, Abdul's putting a little tape on there because in amateur boxing, they like to have a color division there between the gloves and the tank top so you can ascertain whether a blow is legal or not.
That's where they're saying a blow below the belt.
That's right.
As you can see on Valerie's shorts, no tape needed.
Nope. Well, let's see what's gonna happen here. I guarantee you it's fireworks though. I know both these girls. Look for Valerie to come out smoking.
They both look intensely at each other, Dave.
Oh yeah. They're gonna go right at it. Garcia, woo!
She's got the volume.
Smoking, I'm telling you. Garcia's coming to bring it. She's mixing up. Shit, she threw a great uppercut. Nice counter right.
Sauter's landing a good jab, though.
Oh yeah, Sauter's—they're both bringing it. This could be fight of the night or fight of the day. Oh, and the experience.
Valerie's got to bring her hands back to her face.
Yeah.
It seems like
Garcia seems to just kind of have the wherewithal in terms of coming back and punching after Valerie's done and catching her.
Power degrees.
Ooh, nice.
Sometimes that what?
Oh, Sauter gets rocked. Garcia.
Never look away from your opponent.
No.
Dave. That's a.
But you see, this is what it's.
Hard-earned lesson.
It's about Garcia is just a little calmer.
She's a little calmer, and she's always ending the exchanges.
That's right. So now we go to the break here.
And the round's over, just like that.
Round's over. It happens fast. Well, Garcia took the round. Now, what is Brian Grant telling Valerie Sauter?
I would say keep your hands up and keep that jab long and straight.
Yeah. I would say don't worry about pressuring. Let her come to you. Because you see right there, she came in with a jab, dropped her hand, and then she got punched. Now, look at that uppercut attempt. Good. Atta girl. Nice right hand.
I'd say at the beginning of the round, Valerie was landing some good jabs, and I think she should go back to that for the second.
Yeah. Yeah, she shouldn't be trying to chase. Make this young lady come to her.
And I think after the exchanges, she needs to move right away.
Yeah,
she's getting caught on the back end of the exchanges. And Garcia seems all for them.
Oh, yeah. Well, Garcia's doing the smart thing. She's waiting for her to punch, and then she's coming back.
Valerie looks re-energized here.
She does. But what she's got to understand is that you don't want to smother yourself with punches. And you want to start with the jab and then end with a jab after. Now Sauter seems to be concentrating a lot more on it. And that, see, the jab will be useful. Nice long. Oh.
Yeah, back at it with the right hand.
Oh, and Garcia. Oh.
And another.
She is a tough girl. Oh, she's got her running away now. You can't turn around.
Valerie cannot turn around like that.
Valerie's frustrated. And what she's got to do now is not get mad, not want to get even, but understand why she put herself in that position and make the proper adjustments.
Yeah, I think she was winning the first half of the round, but she lost her composure a little bit.
Well, it comes down to this last round.
How would you have it scored, Dave?
Jeez, I can't. I got to go with Garcia both rounds.
I would agree. I'd say the second round was close, but I think Garcia edged it out.
Yeah, I think so too. But let's see what happens in the next round.
You look in the corner there, Abdul was throwing a hook to his fighter, so.
I was showing him to throw the hook.
Get on the inside and punish her.
Well, what she's got to do is just wait for the exchanges to end and then punch back because it seems to work.
Garcia, you're talking about.
Well, that's Garcia. Let's look at this replay here. When Bala uses the jab, it works. Straight punches. And here we go. Nice jab, and that's what the jab does.
When Valerie throws that jab, she keeps her chin down.
That's right.
That's good.
That's right, jab and step around. And I'd like to see the right hand go a little straighter. There, now what's happened is Valerie's realized.
Deer go down to the body there?
Yep.
Good work.
Garcia's just reacting now, but watch Garcia. She's very cagey in the fact that she knows that once the punches stop, she's going to have a few openings. And look at her coming forward now.
She's been having good luck with both hooks.
Yeah.
Double.
Oh, that left hook missed.
Valerie's doing a little better with her movement.
Yeah. Oh, but look at Garcia coming.
She needs to not look away.
There's no quit. Don't turn your head, Val. Come on.
Definitely getting a little frustrated.
That's a common novice mistake.
That was a good fight, Dave.
Yes, it was. Probably the most action-packed of the night. Now, I gotta go with I'd have to probably go with Garcia on that, just based on the merit of the. She was effectively aggressive.
Usually ended most exchanges with an exclamation.
And you know what the judges remember? The last punch is thrown.
Exactly.
But Val, the last round, Val did some very, very, very good things.
Yeah, you have to give it for Valerie in the last round. I think she adjusted nicely. She was moving away from Garcia's lead hand.
Yep. No, Val did a great job. Shit. You know what? I'm proud of both. I'm proud of everyone that's come in here tonight. But those two really stepped up the plate. They threw lots of punches. You know, of course, there's a lot of nerves and stuff like that. And I think that's what kind of caught Val. Was she got the nerves kind of were up a little higher.
Yeah, I think when Garcia overwhelmed her, it was just a little too much to handle.
Yes.
And I think if she had another bout, she'd actually have a lot more luck, you know?
Oh, yeah. This is just the beginning for Valerie.
Here we go to the decision.
Again, fight fans, after three rounds of action, we go to the judges' scorecard for a decision. All three judges score this the same for your winner by unanimous decision. In the red corner, Lorena Gunner Alvarez Garcia.
I have to agree with that decision, Dave.
You can't argue with it.
The judges are on point tonight.
Yeah, you can't argue with it.
I just love seeing two fighters hug it out at the end of a fight.
That's right. Well, it's all good. It's good. You know what it is? It's all good vibes. All good vibes here.
That's what it's all about, Dave.
That's what it should be about.
I remember my last amateur bout, my opponent came to the dressing room before the fight, introduced himself to me, and wished me luck.
That's class.
That is class.
Five fights in, we're doing pretty good tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Are you entertained today? Sweet, we got more entertainment coming for you. We're gonna take a quick break. Get a drink, make a friend, stretch your legs, and we will be back with more Aprons for Gloves action.
We're gonna be taking a 15-minute intermission, and we will be back with more action.
I was younger, you know, in the 80s, it was easier to get kids in the gym. In the 80s, we had Rocky, right? Rocky got kids in the gym. There's no Rocky today. So what we do is we try and, you know, appeal to their sense of adventure.
We've been running this after-school program now in various iterations for about 30 years. So what we do is we offer 3 days a week free boxing training for kids. That involves them coming in, being able to work under a coach, getting healthy snacks, getting mentorship. Basically, it's a program that not only focuses on physical fitness, but also on mental health and building up their self-esteem, building up their resilience.
I was an angry kid before because I didn't really know how to express myself. This was like one of the ways that I could express myself and I wouldn't get really judged because I was just hitting the bag.
I let them be who they want to be. I don't insist that they don't swear. I don't insist that they don't listen to music. They won't. Those are those trivial things that I don't really care about. My main focus is that they interact with each other properly in a healthy fashion, that they show respect to the coaches and to each other, and that they have work ethic.
I thought I was going to be here for like a week, maybe a couple classes, and then just drop out. But there's something about Eastside with their crew and their coaches. It's feel like you're at home.
I love the fact that we provide a safe haven for kids to come and learn about physical health, mental health, discipline, building self-esteem, and you know what they can do in life when they set goals and work towards achieving them.
I had a spot like this when I was growing up. I could go there and work out. I could go there and get a good meal when home wasn't an option. And every time I left that place, I felt good about myself. I felt better about myself.
I like to see kids do better. I like to see the fact that their grades get better. I like to see that they get a little more responsibility. I like to see that they actually, start caring a little bit more about what they're doing. They actually develop more of a bit of self-respect.
It takes funding from the public in order to do that, in order to keep our doors open, in order to make sure that that safe space and the training exists for the people who come here and speak to how it's changed their lives.
You know, Aprons for Gloves keeps the gym going, keeps the kids programs going. What's really important to me is that, you know, between the ages of like 25 to 35 in the hospitality industry are coming together to raise money for these kids. That's huge. The amount of money we've raised is amazing.
We rely largely on donations and sponsorship. Please donate, and this is where your money goes.
You can come by that gym at 3:30 to 5, and you can see where your money's going. It's not smoke and mirrors. This is the real deal.
If any of this sounds like it appeals to you, you want to get in shape, you want to work on not just physical fitness, but mental fitness, you want to build resiliency, come join us. The doors are always open.
Toy fans, it's almost time to watch more people punch each other in the face. But before we do, we'd like to give somebody some money. Were you smart enough to buy a 50-50 ticket when you walked in the door? Yes, get that 50-50 ticket out of your pocket. $265 has been raised. Half of that's going to Aprons for Gloves Boxing Association. The other half will go in your pocket and will likely buy you some very nice drinks while you're here. Tickets ready. The number 377-0176. 377-0176. Right here. Come on, all the way around this way. Come on up. All the way around. Jeremy's down here. He's counted this. Come on all the way over here.
We got a winner.
We're going to match these tickets. If this ticket do they match? Ooh, the suspense is palpable. We have a match, ladies and gentlemen, and a winner. Congratulations.
There we go.
Also, congrats to the Aprons for Gloves Boxing Association. Are we ready? It's time for fight number six. First to the ring from the blue corner, John Fraser.
Big boys, Luke.
I was going to say John Fraser, not so far away from Joe Fraser.
Fight fans, our sixth fight of the night. Three rounds in our AFGBA men's heavyweight division. Introducing first to my left, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the black trunks with white lettering, his official weight, 187 pounds. Please welcome John, Mr. Nice Guy Fraser.
Now let's see how nice he is.
His opponent fighting out of the red corner, wearing the red trunks with white trim, his official weight, 184 pounds. Please welcome Adam, the Grease Goose Serenity.
184. I did not realize they were heavyweights.
Yes, they are. They are heavyweights. Not super heavyweights, but heavyweights. Well, got a big height difference, height advantage for Serenity.
I've seen Fraser train, and he likes to get on the inside and really go for it.
Serenity's a southpaw, so it's going to be interesting.
There he is, right on the inside, banging away, but
Serenity's
he's got
to
be careful.
He's a paramedic, so you know he's good under pressure. Oh, he's rushing in there. Don't get too carried away, gentlemen.
Fraser is sure trying to lay it on, but he's got to keep his hands up.
They are going for it. Adam's throwing lots of uppercuts.
Good. 1-1-2.
Which is smart against a smaller guy, but what you got to understand is you're open if you throw an uppercut too far out. You're open for a count.
So Reddy seems to have some power behind his punches.
He's going for it.
Fraser needs to keep his hands up.
Got Fraser a little discombobulated, and that's the idea. This is 1 minute rounds, right?
But what happened there?
Oh, I think there might have been a little shoelace untied or something.
The water on the ground or something?
Well, it's gonna go anyways.
Oh, his mouth guard fell out.
Oh, I didn't see that with the lighting. The bell's gonna go any second now.
I thought Fraser might have been hurt there for a second.
No. There we go. Oh.
What's your advice for Fraser in this next round?
My advice, he's got a guy coming in strong. So what's happening is Serenity's negating his own height and reach. So what I would try and do is when he's trying to throw those big shots, I would just throw nice, short, compact punches when he's coming in. He doesn't have to chase after the other guy's coming to him. So in a way, Serenity's handcuffing himself. Look at this replay here. He's kind of getting in forward, and he's going in behind the jab, which is smart, but you're seeing he's kind of rushing, and he's smothering his work. You don't want to smother it. want to keep the shorter guy at the end of the punch, right?
I would agree with that. And I think Frazier needs to either keep his hands up at the end of exchanges or tie him up.
Yeah.
Because he's getting kind of caught on the tail end of the exchanges.
Well, let's see what he's got. Oh, that left hand.
Gotta watch out for the southpaw.
Oh, a nice right hand. Oh, nice right hook.
He needs to keep his hands up.
Yes, he does. Get out!
That's good.
Oh, he's no landing brawler. Back.
Get out! Step right and jab.
It's a pier six brawl.
Step right and jab.
Nice. Oh, little slippy slip.
You could witness this at the Roxy on a Friday night.
Blood Alley.
Frazier needs to keep his hands up.
Well, he's got to keep his eye on his opponent. What he should be looking for is a straight right hand left hook with a southpaw. There, just like that. There, again.
And again.
Freddy's getting caught.
And again.
In.
Frazier's putting in that work. He,
another a left hand. What a brawl.
Jeez. Good fight, Dave.
Those right hands were they were pretty darn hard. Both guys were taking a good shot, though.
How would you score this fight so far, Dave?
Oh, man. I think both rounds are pretty darn close. Let's have a look at this little replay here. Now, you see the jab, straight left, nice work. But there, you see, there's no quit this kid. He's throwing right back.
Frazier's a persistent man.
Oh, yeah. There's that right hand. Got to follow it up with a left hook after.
I believe he threw three right hands in a row and did none of them miss.
Oh, but he's got to follow with a left hook and then he'll get a little magic going on.
He's ready. I can't see tonight either.
No.
I think
they're pretty much fighting with their power hands.
Exactly. I think Frazier's squaring up just a tiny bit too much when he's trying to come in. And Soretti's taking advantage of that. Another right hand.
He's looking for the big kibosh. He's looking to catch Soretti coming in. Soretti don't mind his P's and Q's. He might get smacked with one of those right hands.
1-1-2-3.
Oh.
Frazier is coming in strong.
Oh, yeah.
He's taking punishment this round, though.
He's taking these shots, though. Like, they don't seem to really affect him that much. But an accumulation will. Off balance there.
A little bit
Soretti.
Of
Oh, he clipped him there.
He's got it. Oh, hands up. He is throwing caution to the wind.
Woo. Here we go. Soretti's
doubling down on that right hand.
Suck 'em robots. Oh, both boys left it in the ring this evening. My suggestion is that both guys put a little ice on their heads after and curtail the drinking. I don't think they're both going to have headaches tomorrow. They were a lot of clean shots, man.
Corner, Adam, the Grease Goose, are ready.
Man.
you can't argue with it.
That was it was a close fight.
You know, when it's that close, I don't get upset when either or wins, right?
I do think Soretti just had the slightly stronger punches, a little more power.
I think the first round put him over the hump with that fight. The last two rounds were anyone's rounds, but I think that winning that first round the way he did, and guess what? We've got more heavyweights coming up now.
And Dave, you love to see two big boys go at it.
Oh, I like the big boys. Brett McIntyre is going to be taking on Keenan Lee Cornell, and what's going to be another barn burner. I'll tell you, we got some good fights.
That was a hell of a fight.
Well, I'll tell you, that one there, man.
I think you got to give it up to both.
I'm going to start slurring my S's and getting a headache after watching that one.
It's nice when you see two fighters leave it all in there.
Yes, it is. And I'll tell you, they were respectful with each other. That's what this is all about. This is about raising money to help the kids out.
Exactly. Can you tell us a bit about the next contenders, Dave?
I'm going to let my man speak.
Let's bring them out, ladies and gentlemen. First in the ring from the blue corner, Brett McIntyre. Making their way to the ring in the red corner, Keenan Lee Cornell.
There we go. This on paper, this is a good matchup. Height advantage goes to Cornell. But
Cornell in the red and McIntyre in the blue.
Yeah.
Fight fans, our seventh fight of the night, three rounds in our AFGBA men's heavyweight division. Introducing first to my left, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the blue trunks with white trim, his official weight, 197 pounds. Please welcome Brett the Heine Hitter McIntyre. His opponent man fighting out of the red corner, wearing the red trunks with white trim, his official weight, 202 pounds. Make some noise for Keenan Lee Cornell! And the bell, your referee in charge of the action is Derek Hoyt.
I'm predicting someone goes down this front. And it's got that feeling in my old bones.
The look on McIntyre's face confirms your suspicion, Dave.
Well, he's going to try and get Keenan Lee on the ground. Can he do it? Well, that remains to be seen.
That's a face that looks like it's ready to fight.
Oh, yeah. Too bad looks don't win boxing matches. Let's see.
I've seen Cornell in the gym, and there's no lack of tenacity in that man.
I think someone's going down. I just got that feeling. I don't know who, but these are the big guys, and look at this.
Look at the changes, Dave Cornell.
Our man Brett's looking a little worse wearing those exchanges.
I think Brett's got to start boxing here.
Oh man, Brett's got to start just throwing. He's got that southpaw stance. He's got to time that left hand perfectly when the guy comes in.
I don't think I've seen a jab this round.
No. Nice combo. That actually rocked him.
Big left hand. Big left hand.
That rocked him.
Ooh. And the round is over, just like that.
I'm noticing that Keenan Lee's legs look a little stiff. He got the end of left-handed. A lot of people wouldn't feel identify as a hurtful punch, but I think it's stunning. But these are the big guys. Yeah, I think the breath is stunning. Let's have a look at this replay. We really got it.
Slip. Boom, big left hand down the pipe.
That was the one, but that wasn't the one, because the one he did a little bit of a tiny jig. He looks clear now, though.
His legs looked a little stiff walking back to the corner, but...
What do you think Abdul's telling Cornell right now?
I hope he's telling him to step to the left and jab. He's fighting a southpaw, and to shoot the straight right hand after he steps over. Well, let's see. Someone's going down. I just feel it, bro. I feel it. Oh! Oh!
That is. Brett can't miss
that left. That left. He's just standing in front too much against the southpaw.
Cornell needs to not square up and move to the left. Oh, and again.
God, what's holding him up? What a chin. Cornell's got to get back in there. He's got to start imposing his will.
He had luck in the first round, but he's taking a different approach here, Dave.
Yeah, well, like I said, I think he got stung pretty good with the left hand. It kind of made him think twice about coming in, but with these 1 minute rounds, he can't think that much. He's got a punch.
I think Cornell needs to start leaning on the jab. He's physically more present, and he needs to get to work here.
Oh, nice right, nice left. That hurt him. His legs are jammed up there.
100%.
If I'm Brian Grant...
I think Brett thinks he just gave him an eight down there. He walked to the neutral corner.
I think if I'm Brian Grant, I'm telling Brett, forward, left hand heavy, double jab, left hand, right hook, repeat.
And if
I'm telling that guy to stand up. His legs jammed up on him.
Are you thinking this is one apiece or 2-0 Brett? It's tough to say.
I think you could make a case for both guys in the first round, second round, definitely Brett.
Let's see what happens.
Let's see. Coming to bring some smoke. Oh, he got caught right here.
He's starting to figure out squaring his opponent up.
These fights go so fast.
There we go. Cornell's laying it all on the line. I think Abdul riled him up.
He's got to be careful because what's happening is the hands are coming down and chin's going up. That left hand there had some intent behind it.
I think what Cornell's doing is right, actually.
He's doing the right thing. He's trying to get his distance. He's trying to edge to his left.
I don't think he has the jab to win the round, and I think he needs to just lay it all out.
Well, I'll tell you, it's pretty close right now, because he just landed another right hand. Oh, looks like Cornell, I think, edged that round out, bro.
Cornell needs to keep going and not leave it to the...
Oh, I thought for sure someone was going down in this fight.
What a fight.
Oh, they both showed that they could absorb some heavy shots and persevere after. I don't know. I really don't know.
This is a toss-up here. It could be a draw, Dave.
Well, it's a testament to the heart of both these guys. They both took some hellacious shots. Watch this replay.
I think that was eight hooks in a row.
Well, whatever. He was busy. You can't see. No.
I'm interested to see what the judges have to say about this.
I wouldn't want to be a judge for this fight.
I agree with that.
I don't want to say anything. I put my foot in my mouth.
I have a gut feeling I think Brett might have taken it away. Those big left hands in the second round.
I got a gut feeling that maybe Keenan Lee took it with that last round.
Well, we'll have to fight ourselves after if we're wrong.
Yeah, right. Tell you what, I'll buy you a beer if you win the bet.
Fight fans, after three rounds of the back of the judges' scorecard for decision, the judges see this one as a slick distance.
Oh, yeah.
There we go. We'll have to settle
in the blue corner. Brett, the Haida hitter.
Looks like Dave owes me a beer.
Yeah.
I like Corona, by the way.
I'll buy you a black ice or a triple X.
Wildcat, please.
You're getting Wildcat. And a warm one at that.
In my head, I don't even know if I can agree with that decision. It was such a close fight.
You know what? You can't argue.
You know what?
Like, you know what?
Brett may have taken the first round.
Yeah, I think Brett took the first. The second was pretty close, but I thought Tina Lee got the third. You know what? You can't complain. When it's a split decision like that, no one's complaining. Both guys look happy. They both did a good job, and they should be commended.
I mean, Usyk Joshua was a split decision, and there's lots of people complaining.
Well, that judge was totally inept. That was garbage, that fight.
I couldn't agree more.
Oh, let's see now who we got a barn burner coming up.
Rachel Smith and Mona.
Yes. Gonna be a good one. Let's take it back to our bot guy here.
Our next fighters are ready. Let's bring them out. First from the blue corner, Rachel Smith.
Rachel Smith. An Irish transplant, southpaw.
From the red corner, making their way to the ring, Mona Sargi.
It's her birthday today, Mona Sargi's birthday. Will she get a gift? She's in tough, I'll tell you. It's Rachel Smith's a soap on. She can crack. She's a hard, hard woman. Mona in her own right's a tough person. So,
fight fans, our eighth fight of the night, three rounds in our AFGBA Women's Welterweight Division. Introducing first, just to my left, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the blue trunks with white trim and black lettering. Her official weight, 140 pounds. Please welcome Rachel the Hammer Smith.
The Hammer looks composed.
Her opponent fighting out of the red corner, wearing the black and white trunks. Her official weight, 141 pounds. Please welcome Mona, Mistress of Misery, Sargi.
Mona is
at the bell, your referee in charge of the action is Jason Flynn.
I couldn't hear you there, sorry.
Mona is looking extra relaxed in her car.
That can be good and that can be bad. Let's see what she does when she gets smacked hard in the mouth. This Irish girl's tough, man, I'll tell you.
When you're raised off potatoes and whiskey, Dave.
That's not a generalization or anything.
Of course not. It's a fact.
See, look at her coming right out. She's going to come out, and she's going to be looking overwhelmed.
She is not holding back.
No, no. She is a rugged, rugged, rugged person.
That is years of oppression coming out.
I'll tell you one thing. Mona's got to settle down because what's happening here is she's just getting run around the ring.
She's opening her guard up. She needs to keep her shell tight.
Like, she's got to get on track throwing punches. Like running around is okay to a certain extent, but you want some tactical movement.
Exactly. And I would say the first 30 seconds there, Smith was not.
Oh, that left hand. Oh, Smith's a hard nut, I'll tell you.
These southpaws are shooting the left hand down the pipe.
Well, that's what you got to do. 30 or 1 minute in, and you can see that this woman's just.
And again, she's the left
just
hand.
Coming forward. Oh.
The truth is the southpaws get lots of practice fighting orthodox.
That's
and
right.
The orthodox get just a
That's
little
right.
bit of practice fighting southpaws. So.
Quote the legendary Larry Merchant. All southpaws should be drowned at birth. I didn't say it. That's Larry Merchant.
You didn't hear it here, but.
They present problems. Mona's discombobulated. She got bum rushed.
Okay, I, I think she just needs to calm down, keep her guard up, and not square up to her opponent.
Oh, she has to.
Anytime she
squares
up,
she's got to stop and punch, or she ain't going to win it, because she's just going to backpedal her way to losing a decision.
I think she's getting caught off guard with the left hand, and it's she's becoming flustered from it.
Yep. Rachel Smith on a mission. But the openings are there. Rachel's coming in a little reckless. Look at right
at it. Not scared at all.
No.
No respect.
No, this woman's. Well, I hate to say it, but Mona hasn't really given her a reason to stop.
1, 2, 3. And Irish fighters are known for their tenacity, Dave.
Oh, yeah, this woman. I'll tell you, she is a rugged number. Right turn,
Mona's got to just stop putting her head down. She's kind of dancing around. She's got to start looking for jabs. Ooh, she's a left uppercut from left field.
She needs to throw good, strong, straight jabs and disrupt.
That's right. Comes in. That's right.
Make her reset her attack.
Yeah, look, she's just putting too much pressure on him. Mona's not responding properly.
It can happen in a first fight, though, man.
Hey, you know what? Let's be honest here. Everyone that's entered this has done a remarkable job showing composure. No one's quit. But, you know, you're going to see nerves. You're going to see, look at this replay here.
And I actually think Mona stepped it up the last round.
She did, but not enough.
It wasn't enough, but who knows what the third round holds.
Well, I'll tell you, she's down 2 rounds in my books.
Think she needs a knockout?
Yeah. She'd have to unload something big and drop this girl.
Looking at Smith, though, I'm not sure she could knock her out.
Smith's pretty tough.
Smith looks like a robust woman.
Yeah, she is a tough, tough lady. Well, let's see what we got here.
She's smiling in the corner. Brian's giving her a talk, and she gave him a big smile, and she's ready to go.
Nice straight right by Mona. Now Mona's doing what she should have been doing earlier.
Ready, big hit by Smith.
Yeah.
What was that, a left hand?
Yeah, it was a left hand, but also it was kind of, Mona was a little off balance there. But Mona's got to just start looking for the right hand, left hook. But this girl's so strong, she's knocking her off balance even if they're not landing. Like that left there.
That left cannot miss tonight.
1, 2, 1, right?
Look at that.
Good right
it's
hook,
just
too.
So strong.
Very strong.
1, 2, 1, right?
And by the time
Do you think there is a key to victory for Mona?
At this point, big punch lands, and it's not happening. Looks like she didn't.
I don't think Smith can be stopped.
No. Good fight. One-sided, in my opinion. You know what happened was Smith came out and didn't let her get on track, kept her off on her back foot, moving around.
Smith was pretty relentless.
Smith wasn't stopped for nothing. Well, we will see who has won this on the official scorecards. I'm leaning towards Smith on that one. Or will Mona get a birthday gift? With the decision.
Fight fans, after 3 rounds of fabulous action, we are going to the judges' scorecard for a decision. All 3 of them see it the same for your winner by unanimous decision. In the blue corner, Rachel the Hammer Smith.
Both girls very gracious towards each other. Happy birthday, Mona. And now we've got the big boys coming up.
Next, you are ready. There's no time to wait. Let's bring him out. First from the blue corner, Nick Lamb.
Nick Lamb is going to be facing off against an AFG veteran in Brent Thomas. It'll be a very interesting fight.
Making their way to the ring from the red corner, Bryn Thomas.
Now here we go with Bryn Thomas. He's had a couple fights in AFG. This young man has dropped down from 260 pounds to just below 200, an excellent effort. Will his experience.
Our ninth fight of the evening. Three rounds in our AFGBA men's heavyweight division. Introducing first to my left, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the black trunks with gold trim, his official weight, 189 pounds. Please welcome Nick Grass-Fed Lamb. His opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing black trunks with white trim, 195 pounds. Please welcome Bryn the Kid Thomas. Your referee in charge of the action of the bell is Clark McClellan.
So we've got Bryn Thomas, who's had a couple of fights already against the debuting Nick Lamb. This will be interesting. No. Bryn's got the experience, but Lamb's game. I think that Bryn's going to come out and try and make a statement on this one. I think he's going to come out and try and intimidate the smaller man and put a hurting on him early.
Thomas looks very physically robust.
You can see the experience. Lamb's using the distance.
Lamb's moving his head. Lamb's got caught there.
Yeah, Bryn got caught. But Lamb's game, you know, like you can see he's switching levels. Lamb, if I were Lamb, what I would do is I would start looking for a right hand like that. And trying to just
if he lands that could be deadly. Dude.
Yeah, but Bryn's got some power too. Oh, you see, that's a big kibosh there. He was off balance there. That wasn't a punch. But look at Bryn's gonna try and peck away with the jab, and then he's gonna try and bring a big kibosh over with the right hand, and I think
Bryn's doing a good job keeping the distance too.
He is.
He's showing some boxing IQ in there.
Good round. Got to give it to Thomas, just based on ring generalship. But Nick Lamb's doing a good job, man.
So you were saying Thomas has a couple amateurs.
Yeah, he fought an AMG before.
You can tell he has good ring generalship.
Nick Lamb was off balance with that shot. You know, the most significant punch, I think, would have been that right hand that Lamb landed. But if you're looking at the general overall skills, like, look at that, nice counter.
Bryn Thomas has got more skills.
I would agree with that. Lamb is moving his head nicely, though. I was impressed.
Lamb is in this fight.
the bottom line is though, he's got to take a few risks. He's got to make sure, because what you see is Bryn's leaning back to counter with a right hand, and what he's got to do is try and time it when he leans back to land that big right hand.
I think even leading in with a fake or two, or starting with the jab and getting himself on the inside,
that's right,
be a good strategy for him.
That's right. Okay, so let's have a look at what the second round brings us. I have a funny feeling Bryn's coming out to let that right hand go. Left hook, right hand, left. Nice.
Huge right hand by Lamb. Good jab by Thomas.
Lamb's coming.
Lamb has a lot of improvement for a first fight.
Nice right hand. I'd like to see him come back with a left hook after, though. You can't just stop with one. There, see? He's off balance.
And he's already loaded his left leg up. If he just turned over a left hook.
That's right. Nice. 1-1-2. Lamb's got to get busier. He's facing an uphill battle with a more experienced guy.
Thomas seems like the physical presence in the ring.
He is. He's a bigger guy. Got more experience. But that being said, you could see Lamb just shook his head. So Lamb knows he could have done better.
I'm actually quite impressed with Lamb. He's moving his head. He's not letting Thomas establish the jab. Oh. I just think he's getting just outboxed a little bit.
Yeah, he is. It's just that little bit of experience is really making a difference, because you see Bryn's got the eyes. He can kind of lean back, see those shots coming, which is excellent work. But Bryn's been training, you know, he had two or three aprons fights, so, you know, he's been in the system a little longer. But fuck, let's not take anything away from Nick Lamb. He stepped up.
I'd like to see Nick lay it all out this last round. Just give it everything he has.
He's gonna trust me on that one. He's coming out.
Nice jab to the body for Lamb.
If I were Lamb, I would just fucking try and throw. Sorry for my swearing there.
Thomas has that right hand, though, always deadly.
Well, he's got to look for the big right hand. He's got to look for the big right hand.
You don't see many tall guys like that throwing overhand right, but...
No, but Lamb's got to be the one throwing it. He's got to put two jabs together before he throws it, so he can catch Bryn leaning back. There, that's a right hand, but you got to do more, son.
I think if Lamb just threw it a little wider and over the shoulders, he'd catch him. Big left hook there. Lamb is laying it out there. Big respect.
Hands up. Lamb's doing a good job, though. Shit. He's got no experience.
He's a tough guy.
Oh, yeah.
He's taking him to
That
was a good fight, dude.
That was a good fight. Bryn's too big, too much experience. Bryn Thomas took that fight, but let's give a hand to Nate Lamb. That guy showed some big cojones, man. He came in here. It was a tough fight coming in on paper. He knew it, and he brought it.
You're stepping in with a fighter with 2, 3, 4 fights and you have none, and you give it like that.
Oh, yeah.
Nothing but respect.
Yeah, well, you got to look at this replay. You can just see just a little bit of experience allowed Bryn to do things like that, like pull back a little bit, counter.
That was a good technical fight, Dave.
That was a good fight. You can see the skill set. Bryn had a good skill set. And so did Lamb. You can tell just a little bit more refined of a skill set belonging to Bryn Thomas.
I don't think Lamb can be disappointed at all with this performance.
He should be proud.
Both of them looked like they had average experience to me.
Yep. He's trying, you know, but just a lot of experience.
Even having one fight versus zero fights, even getting
that's
the nerves
right.
over,
that's right.
That's huge.
You get it done, you know what it entails, right? Let's see what the judges say.
Four cards for a decision. All three judges score this one the same for your winner by unanimous decision. In the red corner, Bryn the Kid Thomas.
Good decision by the judges, Dave.
Yep, fair decision. We couldn't really see it any other way. Now we are gonna, the next fight, I'll tell you, it's gonna be another case of someone with a little bit more experience coming in with someone with less, but these women are heavyweights.
Have you ever put a fighter in with a more experienced fighter that you thought could, you know, handle it?
Yeah, I did that to you in your first fight. Fought a guy with 9 fights, but I knew you were that damn good.
There you have it, folks.
You can't go too soft nowadays. Everybody's kind of getting soft, and that's convoluting the sport.
You gotta just...
It's amateur boxing. It's not like you're getting paid $1 million.
Don't worry. I still have that Fight of the Night trophy on
myself.
That's
right. Yeah, no.
But you did tell me he had 0 fights.
Oh, I had to get you to take the fight.
Our fighters are ready. Making her way to the ring in the blue corner, Katie Brady.
Katie Brady looking a little pumped up there.
Now making her way to the ring from the red corner, Sarah Collins.
Sarah Common, tough, tough lady. What she got on here? I don't know what that is. Is that some sort of a...
Fight fans, our 10th fight of the evening. Again, 3 rounds. This one in our AFGBA Women's Heavyweight Division. Introducing first, just to my left, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing blue trunks with white trim, her official weight, 177 pounds, please welcome Katie, the Real Slim Brady! Her opponent fighting out of the red corner, wearing the pink trunks with white trim, her official weight, 178 pounds. Make some noise for Sarah Binks Common. At the bell, your referee in charge of the action is Brendan Lowry.
Well, Binks with the advantage in height, reach, and experience. But Katie Brady's a bad woman. It's gonna be an interesting matchup.
Let's go, Katie!
So Sarah Collins is in the red corner.
Yes, sir.
And Katie Brady in the blue.
Hands
up.
There you go, keep
pressure
into your jab, Sarah. Good.
Sarah Common.
Oh yeah, she'll bring it.
Punching nonstop.
This is the rare occasion where I'd say the shorter person might want to try and box the taller person, because Common just is a machine. And the fact that she just throws a lot of punches and she just doesn't really step back. You see, every come behind that jab, but there's a lot of forward movement.
Definitely has volume on it.
Oh, yeah, she's a volume puncher.
It's reminiscent of Gabriel Fundora.
Oh, nice right hand. You see, she's just a little much for Katie at the, you know, at that distance. If I were Katie, I would honestly try and just move around and try and land that right hand like she landed earlier.
Or I think she should weather the storm till Common's done and then try and fire back.
Well, yeah, at this point, I think if she met Binks head on, or Sarah Common head on, she's going to run into a few problems, because it's just that physicality that Sarah Common has. She's a little much. But you see them exchanging there. But it's just that volume punching and the physicality. She is a you know, she's got a bit of a size.
It's funny to see a fight where the taller opponent is working more on the inside.
Well, sometimes it happens. There was a guy years ago that passed away named Diego Corrales, and he was tall and lean, but man, he could fight on the inside, right?
Like I said earlier, if you've ever seen Gabriel Fandora fight 155 pounds at 6'4" or 6'5", and loves to fight on the inside.
Yeah, it's just in their DNA to do so.
Let's see what Brady has for us this round.
Nice, nice try.
If she could sneak that right hand through, she might be able to do some damage.
That's what I think she's been instructed to do.
If you know Brian Grant, you know he likes the right hand, and I'm sure he's feeding that information to his fighters.
Brady is trying her damnedest to get something off, but...
Common is just relentless.
Oh, she is.
She is not scared of Brady's punches. Oh, she is coming forward with intent.
Nice right hand. And look what happens.
And punch combination, dude. Is that an 8 count?
Oh, yeah. And it's well deserved.
I don't think Brady's hurt, but just that volume landed on a fighter at this level.
Physically hurt, but I think that she kind of... You take 5 or 6 shots in a row, you're gonna get a little fatigued. Good, that round. Done. That was the bell. I don't know what happened there.
May as well hit it 3 times to let everyone know. Well,
okay, we got one more round. Sarah Common, just a little too much for Brady, but Brady is making a good accounting of herself.
Do you think Brady can turn it around this last round?
No.
I don't think so either. Common seems absolutely dominant.
There are no breaks on the Common train. This woman is gone.
There is actually nothing Common about her boxing style. I would like to see Brady leave it all there. All in the ring this last round. If she could sneak a couple big right hands in, it would be nice.
I think so too. But she came in knowing she was going to have a tough fight.
Have either of them had any amateur experience?
Yeah, Sarah Collins had one fight.
Makes sense. The way she moves in the ring, you can tell she is.
But look at this. This Brady's doing great and turns it like she's moving.
Brady.
This is her first fight. She only started training 3 months ago. There, nice try with the right hand.
That right hand.
Dude, I'll tell you, there's a future for this woman because I'll tell you, she's got the right idea. She just came up against someone that's just been training like twice as much, maybe 3 times as much. So she was at a bit of a disadvantage coming here. And there's not women at this weight, not many. So we made this fight to get both of them a fight. And, God damn it, if she isn't making a good account of herself.
I gotta say, Brady is one tough.
Oh, yeah, she's. I knew, not even
phased.
No, and she's one of those ones. Like, I knew she'd be at an experience deficit, but she's got that outstanding character. And look at this. You know, she was in there. She did what she could.
That was a hell of a fight.
Yeah, we knew this would be a tough fight going in. But you know what? She handled it with class, she showed heart. She did a great job. Sarah Common did what Sarah Common always does, and that's like stalk people.
Absolutely.
Walk them down and
bully in the ring.
Oh, yeah. Lovely person in real life, but in the ring, she's a very focused and intense individual.
You don't often see a taller opponent land 4 body shots in a row.
Oh, no. She's a driven person.
There you go, right on the replay there.
But I love them all. Both these girls are good. They are exceptional people. Well, Katie Brady doesn't look any worse for wear.
Yeah, it's always good to hug it out afterwards. How about a big round of applause for these two?
I love to great see two athletes smiling after that.
We're going back to the judges' scorecards after 3 rounds. They see it for
look
the
at
winner
Common's
by
smile.
Unanimous
he had a
decision.
Great time in there.
In the red corner, Sarah Bates Common.
Yeah, you know what? Both girls did great. You know what I like about this? You look at this woman, Katie Brady did the best she could. She was up against it, but look at her. She's smiling, she's showing class, she's showing like this is what it's all about.
I'm not gonna lie, I don't think I'd want to go in there with you.
Sarah Coleman's a bad woman too.
Absolute beast.
Yeah, she is. Yeah, I love both these people, man. They are awesome. But you see the size difference looking there right now. Coleman's about a foot taller.
How tall is she, dude?
I think she's close to probably 5'11". Taller than me, which don't take much.
I would agree with that. And maybe some would say longer.
Never mind. So here we got some heavyweights coming up here.
Who do we have next, Dave?
Let's keep this action going, fans. Making his way to the ring from the blue corner, Tristan Catcher.
Colin O'Brien versus Tristan Catcher. The big boys.
Fighting out of the red corner, Colin O'Brien.
We have another Irishman here entering the ring.
Fight fans, our 11th fight this afternoon. Three rounds in our AFGBA men's heavyweight division. Again, introducing first, just to my left, fighting out of the blue corner. Wearing the blue trunks with a white trim, his official weight, 195 pounds. Please welcome Tristan, the Kindness Catcher. His opponent, the man fighting out of the red corner. Wearing the red trunks with white trim, his official weight, 202 pounds. Make some noise for Colin Late Night O'Brien. At the bell, your referee in charge of the action is Derek Hoyt.
This will be interesting. You got a taller guy that's he's actually a surprisingly good defensive fighter for the amount of experience.
And I'd say he's a little awkward but has some good skills to show for it.
Yep. Tristan's tough too. Tristan's, you know, he's we're both new at it, but Tristan definitely has come a long way.
Rushing right in there. Colin seems extremely eager to engage.
Yeah. Tristan's got to relax, though. I'm not liking that. Like, he seems very stiff. And that's when you walk into a shot. He's got to relax. I know it's one-minute rounds, but.
You got to think most amateur bouts are 3 3-minute rounds.
They start off in the novices 3 2-minute rounds, which is twice as long as these. Tristan's got to breathe, he's got to relax, he's got to remember what he's learned in the gym. That's it, it'll come.
I think Colin is sticking to a good game plan. Long punches.
Yeah, Colin's being smart. Colin's being very smart. Oh, Tristan's got to stop running in, he's just got to breathe. Hopefully Brian Grant calms him down.
I'd say that was a round for Colin.
Oh, for sure. Tristan just got to get his, you know, he's got to get his faculties together. He's got to just relax.
I think he's got to work on pinning Colin down in one area. The guy's a jumping bean. He's all over the ring.
Yeah, but doing it in a way where he's not going to rush in. Because you see sometimes when you rush in, you got your right hand. Your hands were down, your chin was up, so you're walking into a shot.
Exactly. He's got to walk him down, get him on the ropes, and put his work in.
See that right hand?
Good body shots and some good right hands.
Ah, these Irishmen are tough, aren't they? It's a different world over there.
Let's go, buddy. Hands up, hands up.
Colin, right back at it.
Tristan's just got to calm down and let the hands go, but doing it in a responsible fashion. Right there, that hurt.
Huge right now.
Colin looks ready to go.
He's a determined guy. Abdul Fidel calling for an uppercut. Oh, he got wobbled there.
Tristan needs to fire back here or tie him up.
Yeah, right, there, you right, there you go.
There he did it. Tied him up.
That's right.
It's the best thing you can do when you're in trouble.
Yep. Almost there.
Colin is showing some good boxing skills tonight, though.
Yeah, he was the guy that I noticed, you know. He wasn't like a big puncher or anything, but he was consistent and he seemed to have the right instincts. Tristan's has got to figure it himself. He's going to win. It's going to be, bottom line, it's going to be a big punch in landing.
I have a hard time imagining him landing that big punch, but I hope Brian is communicating that information to him. I hope he executes on it.
No, Brian, just judging by the way he's gesticulating there, he's telling him to keep the hands up.
I think Tristan knows he needs this round.
Oh, yeah. Problem is when you walk into big shots like that, they're kind of a little apprehensive to get in there.
Have you ever got your ass whipped by an Irishman, David?
Have I? Not yet. If you're saying you, forget it. You'd never whip me, son.
Hands up, Colin.
They're back at it.
Hands up.
I'm a little nervous for Tristan right now because he just seems to be biting a lot of those fakes, biting for a lot of those fakes, and he's not having a problem getting in there.
I just think Colin might be a little too long for him.
I think he is.
And that jab in that right hand, Colin's really doing nothing fancy.
You know, and here's the thing. Tristan lost a lot of weight coming in this.
How much did he lose?
I think he's probably lost about 15 pounds. But the thing is, you know, if he wants to do this again, he might think about walking, you know, getting down to another weight class, because these are big boys at that weight class. And this, Brian's he's a big guy.
Even look at the shoulders on Colin.
Yeah.
I don't think Tristan's leading well with his dad.
Oh, and that's all right. Hey, listen, the guy got in shape. He learned the skill. He got some discipline. And you know what? Not everyone's going to come out of here with the W. But
I would say Tristan was a tough contender.
Yeah. No, a tough fight for him. You know what? He survived. He did his job. He had fun doing it.
That's all you can ask.
Yeah. Let's keep in mind, this is a charity boxing event. This isn't, you know, this isn't high-stakes stuff. Like, you know, for them, it's a big deal because they work so hard. But at the end of the day, it's a fun event. Kid did good. He should be proud of himself. I'm proud of him.
Couldn't agree more, Dave.
Oh, we're coming up on the big one now. The main event of the daytime card.
I think that's a shutout for Colin in that round.
Yeah, you can't see it any other way. Yeah. Like, Tristan went in there, he tried his hardest, but he was just fighting a guy a little too big.
You know, big respect for Tristan.
Yep.
Fight fans, let's hear it for these two. Make some noise. Excellent work. Again, after 3 rounds, the winner of the scorecard for decision. All three judges see this the same for their winner by unanimous decision. In the red corner, Colin Late Night O'Brien.
Couldn't call it any other way.
Good choice sportsmanship from the Irishman.
Both are excellent guys. You know what, during this whole thing, there hasn't been a person that wasn't great. So now we're coming up on the main undercard main event, Candace Buell. This is Una Craig. This is going to be a barn burner.
I heard, uh, I I've never seen Una fight, but I heard she's a force to be reckoned with.
Una's kind of like Sarah Common. They just don't stop, right?
All right, everybody, we got two more boxers to bring out. Let's raise
That's
the roof
That's what some people say
place.
When you're talking
First
to
up from the blue corner, Candace Buell.
Candace Buell making her way to the ring. She is actually 1-0 in AFG. She fought, I believe it was 2019.
Has Una had any amateur experience?
None. But when you see Una, you're going to see quite the specimen.
Making their way to the ring from the red corner, Una Cream.
She's one of those people that could, that just naturally ripped. She's quite the specimen.
Exactly not like me.
Or me, my man.
At least we know it.
Oh yeah. But you see, ripped, tall, strong. But let me tell you, Candace Buell is one tough
fight
lady.
Fight fans, for our 12th and final fight of the afternoon, three more rounds in our AFGBA Women's Light Welter. Have to yell, it's okay. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the black trunks with gray trim. Her official weight, 132 pounds. Please welcome Candace Buehler's Day Off Buell. Her opponent, fighting out of the red corner, wearing the black trunks with white trim. Her official weight, 136 pounds. Make some noise for Una Blitzkrieg! Your referee in charge is Mr. Jason Flynn.
Una's another one of those tall people that comes forward a lot, right? So expect her to jump on Candace Buell early. Look for Candace to engage back. Got to weather the storm, though. Cat's got to weather that storm, because I know Una's coming out hard.
And Buell fight on the inside?
A little bit, but I'll tell you, Buell's a tough character. But Una just kind of, you'll see what I'm talking about.
Either of them shying away from the fight.
No, that's why this is the main event. There's no quitting either. Look at this. Like, there's...
Buell needs to like not said, look away when she gets
Candace has got to weather the storm.
Buell needs to keep her hands up, though. She is getting tagged by Una.
Oh, Una lays off a bit. Let's hope she doesn't regret that decision later. Una smiling when she's getting smashed.
Probably more punches thrown than every.
Oh yeah, that's why we made this the main event, because we knew these girls were gonna go, and look at them go. Wow.
Man, amazing first.
I'm sweating and out of breath just watching this.
Dave, you're sweating and out of breath walking up the three stairs to the small platform we're sitting in.
God, you have a corny sense of humor.
Thank you.
So, Una took, she bushwhacked her. Look at, she just came forward. And that's what I said.
You think Una took the bushwhack?
Una took it. You just look now, she's pushing her back. She's landing a more effective shot. The question is, can Buell come back?
I think she can.
Let's have a look.
She's a tough one to crack.
Oh yeah, Buell, they're both tough.
I think she needs to just throw
Well, she's got to force the bully back. Una's the bully. She's not really. She's a great person, but she's got to push her back now. She's got to let her have a little taste of her own medicine.
Being the bully is a term of endearment in boxing.
Let's see what you got going here. Bill's got to keep that eye on that opponent.
Right, throw your two, Candace.
She's showing some good movement.
Yeah.
Seems to be having a hard time hitting her.
But Buell's got to see push. Oh, God. It's rugged. But Buell's got to push her back and see how she reacts going backwards. Everyone's a tough person going forward, but when you push them back a bit, the game plan tends to change a bit. Nice right hand. Oh, nice right hand.
Luna has precision.
Yeah. And she's got leverage. Oh.
I think
it's those right hands are making it. But look at Candace, ain't got no quit in her.
Candace has no quit in her, but she definitely needs to keep her hands up.
Ah, it count there.
I think if Candace kept her hands up and tried to work the inside, it'd be her best bet.
Wow. That looks good on paper, but
Una. Harder said than done.
Una's got a tall order to handle. Now we got the rounds in.
I would say Una's up 2-0 right now.
Yeah. Well, you can see the look of exasperation on Candace's face there.
This is a good fight, though, Dave.
No, there's nothing wrong with it. And I'm going to be honest. You know, Candace has got a busy, busy life. And she wasn't in the gym as much as she could have or should have been. Not could have, because she's trying her best. But if she had a little bit more time in the gym, it would have been a different story. But you know what? She's here. She's doing it. Good enough for me, man. She's really trying. Let's go. It's the final round.
Candace has to leave it all on the line right now, Dave.
Oh, yeah.
She's going for it.
Oh, yeah. She's a dude. There's no quitting this woman.
Hands up, just
those straight punches. Una's smart. She's throwing the straight shots.
Those long, gangly fighters, Dave.
Yeah. But you know what? She's not doing anything too fancy.
Exactly. I don't think she's thrown a single hook this entire fight.
Dude, that's what works at this level. When you're a novice, you don't want to be throwing, too many wild punches. You want to keep them nice and straight and get that part of the technique down.
I actually don't think I even knew how to throw a hook on my first fight. Literally.
Oh, Candace is. Candace looks a little more disappointed than hurt.
What happened there? She crouched down in the corner.
No, no. Well, she's exasperated. She's like, how do I get this fucking psychopath off me?
Candace got to keep going. She's got 30 more seconds.
Candace is looking at the corner. The bell is rung. It's over.
That's the round.
There we go.
And what a fight.
First round was very competitive. Second round, you saw Una kind of take over. But look at Candace did it good.
You can't fault either fight. That was a great fight.
No, I'm impressed.
I gotta say, Una has the skills to pay the bills.
Yeah, like I said, I'm not making any excuses for her, but Candace had a pretty busy life. And she got, she did as much training as she could. It should have been a little more, but she's still here, and I admire that. This is our final bout of the evening, or of the day show. Join us later on. Join us at 7:30.
All three of our judges score this the same for your winner by unanimous decision. In the red corner, Una Blitzkrieg.
You can't argue.
Be disappointed with the fights tonight.
No, I'm not. The fights have been great. Everyone, no one got hurt. That's the most important thing. No one got hurt. No one got, embarrassed. Well, that's why we do
someone
this.
Someone did dislocate their shoulder. But in boxing, we don't count that as hurt.
Well,
shit. He didn't even want to go to the hospital. That guy, he got the doctor to pop it back in, I think. And I think he's got a beer in his hand as we speak.
Fight fans, like before we wrap this all up tonight, it's my pleasure to bring up the executive director of Eastside Boxing, Kendra Moeller, to share some closing remarks. Also joining her, please, big round of applause for the Eastside Boxing Club gym manager, Ellie Willick. Ellie's been running around like crazy all day. We appreciate everything you've both done.
I've been like watching at various points back there, back here, and I'm just like screaming my lungs out and then checking myself and being like, wait, I actually have to talk at the end of this, so like rein it in. So anyways, I'd like to first reiterate a thank you to all of our contenders and their supporters. You're very much at the heart of this success. And the month leading up to it, all of that success, it's all about you guys. So let me say, I'm very, very proud of our contenders and of their achievements. Whatever your outcomes in the ring today may have been, keep in mind that you've accomplished a feat that few will ever even consider attempting. So it's really inspiring and it's commendable. So for a little bit of context, I'd like to tell you a bit about myself and about my involvement with Eastside and with AFG. I started at Eastside as a very tentative and very timid first-timer back in 2017, and I gradually worked my way up to competing in Restaurant Rumble for 2 years, and those were the last 2 years before the pandemic hit. So those 2 years that I competed were an absolutely pivotal time in my life. I still have my AFG vision board up on my wall in my living room at home. I still have my title belt proudly on display in my living room as well. So this year, the event is really notable for two reasons. First of all, it is the 10th anniversary of Restaurant Rumble. And secondly, it is our first year back post-COVID. So that's a really big deal for us. So being that it was a really big year, this time around, I wanted to be involved in the production of this event. Specifically, I wanted to show up and do my best to give to each of our contenders an opportunity to experience what I did, the most grueling and yet most rewarding summer of their lives, and perhaps a transformation. The AFG contender experience, if you do it all in, is not just a commitment, but it's a journey. And it's not just a journey to the ring, but it's a journey of introspection, education, and for many, reclamation, a proving ground of sorts, and metamorphosis. I've spoken to quite a few contenders over the past few months about what their personal journeys have entailed and about what they hope to take home from this experience, belt or medal notwithstanding. Stories may have differed in specifics and in nuance, but they've all shared a common thread, the pursuit of self-improvement. In particular, developing or honing the very traits that we espouse in Eastside's mission statement. Traits like prioritizing physical and mental health, confidence and self-esteem, integrity in our actions and in our words, diligence and strong work ethic, humility and respect for others, and resilience. Most of our contenders can speak to how improving themselves in these ways has changed their lives for the better. So we know that this whole experience has been life-changing for these adults within our club. Now I ask all of us to think about the impact we can have if we can instill these values and develop this same strength of character within the kids in our community. How much different would the world around us look if kids can develop these attributes that some of us are only now picking up well into our adulthood? This is what Eastside's youth program is all about. This is where your money and your support goes. Through the discipline of sport, the guidance of mentorship, and the encouragement that a tight-knit, highly motivated community provides, Eastside is empowering kids to make better choices for themselves and for their futures. We are guiding them to develop the mindset that not only are prosperity, health, and happiness viable outcomes, but we teach them the tools to actively set and pursue those goals. So, to everyone who's competed here today, win or lose, to everyone who has trained their asses off, didn't get a fight, and yet still showed up here today to support your fellow contenders, be proud of yourselves. I'm very proud of you. And to all the contenders, to everyone who donated, to our coaches, our volunteers, our officials, sponsors, everyone who has made this event a resounding success, thank you. Yeah. Thank you not just for making Restaurant Rumble happen, but thank you for everything that Eastside can continue to provide to the kids as a result of your blood, sweat, tears, and generosity.
As Kendra mentioned, this event would not have been what it was tonight without the hard work of our contenders and our coaches, who we are so grateful to work with. But there's a few other people that I would like to take a moment to thank tonight. Thank you to Dave, I don't know where he went. Thank you to Dave and to Kendra, who have been the heart and soul of Aprons for Gloves over the last 3 months. Thank you to Dr. Malcolm Rondeau and Stephen Reed, all the Boxing BC officials who are here today, as well as our amazing production team, including Francois, Stefan, and the whole Brass Tacks team, to Guy Rowland and Charlotte Poro, our amazing photographers, Rachel Warner, who made all of our banners, our graphics, our posters, Christopher Smith and Anthony Grattle, who put together all of the videos that we've seen today. Of course, thank you to our lovely host, Don Andrews, to Jen Alexiuk and her beautiful dancers. We can take a minute to clap for them. No? Yeah. thank you to DJ Koji and, of course, all of the Enzo staff who have made this event happen today. We are also very grateful for all of our sponsors for their support. So thank you to Mikado Martial Arts Supplies, White's Location Equipment Supply, Go Wireless, Intercom Lux Security, and Knockout King Promotions. And, of course, like Kendra said, thank you to everyone who is here, who bought tickets, who donated, and showed up to see your friends get punched in the face for a good cause. If you would like to donate, you can find links on the Eastside Boxing website, the Aprons for Gloves website, or any of our contenders' fundraiser pages. With your help, our contenders have raised over $120,000 that will go directly to our youth program. And from the bottom of my heart, and I know I speak for all of the staff and coaches and everyone at Eastside and the AFG team when I say thank you for allowing us to continue doing what we love to do at Eastside and in our community. Thank you.
One more time, Kendra Moeller and Ellie Willick, thank you so much. And fans, thank you all for joining us for the 10th anniversary of Aprons for Gloves. Aprons for Gloves. This is, again, the 10th anniversary. We've got a whole other show. Thank you for joining us for the first portion of the show. There's another portion coming. We hope to see you there. One more thing. Trainers, please, trainers, come and pick up your boxing record books. Fighters, come and see the officials. Come and pick up your boxing record books. We're shutting this down, and we'll see everybody around 7 o'clock.
When I was younger, you know, in the 80s, it was easier to get kids in the gym. In the 80s, we had Rocky, right? Rocky got kids in the gym. There's no Rocky today. So what we do is we try and, you know, appeal to their sense of adventure.
We've been running this after-school program now in various iterations for about 30 years. So what we do is we offer 3 days a week free boxing training for kids. That involves them coming in, being able to work under a coach, getting healthy snacks, getting mentorship. Basically, it's a program that not only focuses on physical fitness, but also on mental health and building up their self-esteem, building up their resilience.
I was an angry kid before because I didn't really know how to express myself.
from the Howdy, and this was like one of the ways that I could express myself and I wouldn't get really judged because I was just hitting the bag.
I let them be who they want to be. I don't insist that they don't swear. I don't insist that they don't listen to music they want. Those are those trivial things that I don't really care about. My main focus is that they interact with each other properly in a healthy fashion, that they show respect to the coaches and to each other, and that they have work ethic.
I thought I was going to be here for like a week, maybe a couple classes, and then just drop out. But there's something about Eastside with their crew and their coaches. It's feel like you're at home.
I love the fact that we provide a safe haven for kids to come and learn about physical health, mental health, discipline, building self-esteem, and you know what they can do in life when they set goals and work towards achieving them.
I had a spot like this when I was growing up. I could go there and work out. I could go there and get a good meal when home wasn't an option. And every time I left that place, I felt good about myself. I felt better about myself.
I like to see kids do better. I like to see the fact that their grades get better. I like to see that they get a little more responsibility. I like to see that they actually, start caring a little bit more about what they're doing. They actually develop more of a bit of self-respect.
It takes funding from the public in order to do that, in order to keep our doors open, in order to make sure that safe space and the training exists for the people who come here and speak to how it's changed their lives.
You know, Aprons for Gloves keeps the gym going, keeps the kids programs going. What's really important to me is that, you know, between the ages of like 25 to 35 in the hospitality industry are coming together to raise money for these kids. That's huge. The amount of money we've raised is amazing.
We rely largely on donations and sponsorship. Please donate, and this is where your money goes.
You can come by that gym at 3:30 to 5, and you can see where your money's going. It's not smoke and mirrors, it's the real deal.
If any of this sounds like it appeals to you, you want to get in shape, you want to work on not just physical fitness, but mental fitness, you want to build resiliency, come join us. The doors are always open.